Hey, everybody. Welcome to the Quacks Podcast. Now, today I have an interview that I've been working on for a while now. I've dived into a lot of different topics on the podcast, as you know. But one thing I've always kept at arm's length is cancer. Now, the reason being, I have never found much online that I thought was a really good natural therapy. At least where I could say, yes, this seems like something I can share that will really improve people's lives. There are so many resources online that, you know, if you do research, you can make informed choices that will give you a serious edge in life. You know, I've talked about EMF, talked about diet, plastics, all these things can really give you a serious edge in life. But with cancer, it just seemed very murky whenever I would look into it. So when a friend of mine from church got diagnosed with breast cancer, and then a college basketball player emailed me asking for cancer tips, I really wanted to find a naturopathic doctor who was experienced in the topic and could unmurk things for me. The problem is, naturopathic doctors who talk about cancer online are attacked mercilessly by big pharma, mainstream doctors. There are Twitter accounts that are dedicated just to attacking naturopaths whenever they talk about cancer. I mean, it's kind of nuts. So most of the emails I sent out asking for interviews were unanswered, or I got a swift rejection. Now, thankfully, Dr. Cheryl Kollin had the bravery to come on and talk. Now, Dr. Kollin is the medical director at Brio Medical, located in Scottsdale, Arizona, so here at home. They provide many different alternative therapies, and their philosophy is the synergistic intersection of alternative and conventional medicine based on the principle that a healthy body does not develop the disease with an intact immune defense system. They believe each person is unique, and the approach to maintaining and improving health and healing is holistically treating the mind, body, and spirit all simultaneously. And I think you're going to like this one. There are definitely some helpful nuggets in there. So enjoy the interview. All right, everybody. Welcome to the Quacks Podcast. I have Dr. Cheryl Kollin with me. Dr. Cheryl, thanks for coming on.
Well, thanks for having me.
Yeah, why don't we start with just talking a little bit about what you do. I know you practice here in Arizona. So yeah, if you could tell the audience kind of what you do and how you came to do what you do, that'd be great.
All right. Sure. I'm actually practicing at Brio Medical, where I'm the medical director and a small shareholder as well. So we basically see cancer patients and of all types, of all stages, all types of cancers. And we do that, and it's fun. We have a really good group of people always coming through the clinic. And I started out, gosh, I'd have to say, years ago in college, I had a class called Chemistry and Cancer. And that just really, you know, kind of got my brain going, and loved it. And then I went on and knew I was going to end up in this field. I worked with an oncologist in California for several years doing research and clinical research as well. And then, you know, that kind of led me into this when I started to realize that, you know, reading patient charts that many of them were on medications or they didn't know how, you know, to have manage a nutritious diet, things of that sort. So then I became a nutritionist. And then after I did that, I just figured, oh, it would just be easier if I just went back to medical school and did it, you know, myself instead of relying on other people. So.
Gotcha. You know, it was really hard to get somebody on the podcast who was willing to talk about cancer and alternative therapies. So let's just talk about that real quick. Why is it so hard to get naturopaths to talk about cancer? I mean, are there disclaimers you have to give or something like that?
You know, I don't know. I mean, I thought we all loved talking about it, but you know, we do know that the cancer industry is a huge, you know, money maker. And so, you know, I don't know if that is it. I know it. Doing alternative cancer care is not, and I'm putting this in quotations, like the standard of care. So we're doing it outside, you know, what is supposedly allowable. But in the state of Arizona, you know, that's okay. We can do it. You know, and oftentimes, you know, we do a combination approach. I mean, you know, we really have to do what's best for the patients. It's not about, hey, this has to be just natural or this has to be just conventional. No, you know, we want to do whatever's best for the patient.
Gotcha. So as the medical director at Brio Medical, let's dive into a little bit more of what your facility does.
Oh, this is, gosh, we do so many things. This is where it becomes exciting because we're not conventional. We have that ability really to do a lot of things. And so when we, you know, we see a patient, I'll just kind of give you a kind of what we do when patients come in.
Yeah, that'd be great.
And we put patients in a program and they'll come in for like 6 weeks. And once they're in the program, we can basically do anything then. I mean, so we're not itemizing. We're not saying, oh, gosh, we gave the patient a pain injection or, you know, we gave them, you know, acupuncture, better, you know, tag that on. No, we're not itemizing everything, you know, that we feel that is going to help the patient out, we're going to do. So the patient will come in at 9 a.m., you know, 9:30 in the morning, and we begin the treatment. They get a clipboard. It tells them what they're going to be doing for the day. And then maybe we might, you know, divide some of the patients, and some of them will start doing some IVs, and I'll come up with their treatment plan, you know, including the IVs, how many times they're going to be doing whatever, all the devices that we have, and their supplements, you know, all that. So I get to be, you know, I do all of that. And then they come in, they'll get, based on their cancer, you know, they'll maybe do hyperthermia. They may do ozone sauna. We have hyperbaric. We have two hyperbaric chambers. One's a hard shell and the other is a soft shell, but it can allow for like up to three people in there. So those who are claustrophobic, it does help, you know. And you wouldn't realize. I mean, there are there's people who do not want to be in it. I call it a time capsule. So it just kind of looks like, it just looks, you know, like a little white pill.
Interesting.
And we have a laser light bed that kind of looks like a tanning bed, only it's a red laser light, and that really helps to helps the health of the mitochondria. And a lot of sports teams have this device because they, you know, they're paying a lot of money for their athletes, and, you know, they can't have them be injured. So this helps to, you know, heal tissue and, you know, helps with arthritis, you know, things of that sort, even neuropathies. So we look at that, and then we have laser, or I could say we do have lasers. We have cold lasers. We have acupuncture. We have lymphatic drainage. We just have so many different techniques here that we can employ. We have pulsed electromagnetic frequency therapy. I mean, it's just it's fun. It's a lot of stuff, and we have, like I said, all different types and cases of people, but it's just a really, I mean, I love the job, and I, you know, love to interact with all the patients and hear their stories, and they're, you know, they're just fascinating.
Yeah. So what you said, people come in around 9 a.m. So when somebody signs up for treatment, I mean, I have no idea how this works. So do they get like 30 days of treatment? Like, do they come in every day for 30 days? Are they coming in once a week, or does it depend? Like, how does that work?
Right. Everyone, it's mostly they're going to come in Monday through Friday. Usually it's, 9 to 3 or 4 or 5. It depends on how quickly they can get through the, gamut of devices and, you know, the different things that we want them to do, you know, including nebulizing. I mean, it could be anything. And so they're going to come in every day, Monday through Friday. But there are, like, we do take local patients and we put them in the also under, you know, as a program patient, and we may have them come in 3 days a week, you know, so that way some of them maybe still are working, or, you know, they're doing some other things, then, you know, we kind of like let them not have to come in every day, but, you know, we may still have them come in every day. It really does vary. Everyone is, you know, because everyone is unique. They're all their treatments are unique. It's really all just for them. So we don't really mix and match people. Some of the devices might be the same, but the supplements and the IVs are completely, you know, all going to be different, just, you know, for whatever we need to deal with. Because we're going to be working on the whole body. That's how we see it. Cancer is not just a disease of, you know, the organ. It's a disease of the body. So we need to look at, you know, everything to put that back into balance.
Yeah. So, and do they go for how many? I mean, do they do this for a month? Do they do it for 6 months? You know, how long is the average that people would be under the treatment?
The program is a 6-week program, but, you know, people stay longer often. So it really depends. I mean, oftentimes, you know, we're looking to minimize tumor. If you're doing it naturally, you know, it's going to take time. I always use the analogy that if you had an abrasion on your knee, it takes, you know, probably a month really to heal that.
Yeah.
So, you know, cancer is not going to heal overnight. It didn't start overnight. It's, you know, it takes time, but that doesn't mean the body cannot heal it. We know we get cancer for two reasons. We get cancer because we're not giving the body something it needs, and that usually is, you know, a nutrient or something of that sort, or we're giving the body something it doesn't need, and that's going to be like everything else, toxicities, stress, anxiety, you know, you can name it.
Yeah. And is it just cancer that you guys see, or do you guys see other ailments?
We see mainly cancer. Autoimmune disease is another one. And then we work with another clinic to do Lyme and mold. So by working with them, we have Lyme and mold specialists, but they want to use our devices, or, you know, like I said, our hyperthermia or our PEMF machines, you know, things like that. So we kind of work with them.
So I'm kind of curious, which IVs do you like for cancer?
I like, you know, of course we do the high dose vitamin C. I think everyone does that, but I like curcumin. I like, a hydrogen peroxide.
Wow, you guys do turmeric and an IV?
Not turmeric. We do curcumin.
Yeah, the turmeric extract. Wow, that's really interesting. I've never heard of somebody doing an IV of that.
Yeah, I mean, it's very good for inflammation, and then in higher doses, it helps against metastasis. You know, we do artesunate or artemisinin. You know, there's poly-MVA, there's salicinium. You know, the list goes on. There's really, so many of them. Quercetin.
Wow.
You know, sodium bicarb. Yeah. So all of these are, you know, we use them on, you know, just depends kind of on the cancer or, you know, what we're looking at. So, you know, if someone tells me, gosh, you know, I have this infection or I run a test and find out they have Epstein-Barr virus, I may add some, you know, ozone therapy or, you know, or maybe, you know, artesunate for that.
Okay. So let's take an example. And if this is proprietary information, you know, just let me know. But let's say somebody comes in with breast cancer. What would, like, your go-to therapies look like?
Actually, they're going to be different on everybody. I mean, that's because, as I said, stated earlier, everyone's unique. So, you know, are they triple positive or triple negative? Or, you know, do they have swelling in their arm? You know, everything is different. So we're going to take that into account at where they're at, what's their vitality, you know, go from there. And also, are they currently doing chemotherapy? You know, in which case I have to maybe change their treatment, you know, differently than I would do. So,
okay. How would
that's kind of,
yeah. How would chemotherapy change things?
Well, I mean, we may not want to use glutathione or something, you know, so, you know, that would be something that we would look at. Nothing, you know, we wouldn't want to use something that interferes, or, you know, we may not even want to do chemo on the same day as we know we do an IV. Or actually, I should say, we don't want to do an IV on the same day as we do chemotherapy, because we may not want to, you know, overburden the liver. things of that sort. So,
okay. Interesting. So in your emails, you said you had some new things that you wanted to share. What are those?
Well, basically that we just recently expanded at Brio, and we now have, in the same building, we have two offices. So we now have the acupuncture. We have another doctor that we hired, and he does a lot of the acupuncture and some pain treatments. And then we actually have massage or lymphatic drainage. We use that. And then we have a medical doctor here as well that works with and uses a lot of conventional medicine in a outside the box, rather. He's really brilliant at it, and he'll take targeted therapies, and he'll find out what your cancers are overexpressing, and he'll use these targeted therapies to inhibit that. So that can allow for quicker results while I get to turn around and like balance the body. So it's really a synergistic program. We also got, like I said, that we got a second hyperbaric machine, just so that way, people who are claustrophobic, we can, open that up, and there's a little more space in there so they don't feel it. And they can, two people can go in there and play cards. I believe that, the patients need to laugh and have fun. And I believe laughter is a medicine. And so I'm always trying to crack jokes with them.
That's great.
Do something,
Yeah. One thing I notice when I read about natural remedies for cancer is they tend to throw everything at it. You take vitamins, meditate, change your diet, take these herbs, do these IVs, exercise, which is great. But I always, when I read that, I always kind of find it hard to tell what's actually working. And so part of why I was excited to talk to you is that you've been at this for years. And so you've kind of got that experience of, I think this stuff works a little bit better, and I think these things don't work as well. So what do you find from your years of experience really has the most consistency in helping?
I would say that ozone and mistletoe are really big hitters for a lot of people. We do throw everything at them, and that's simply because I don't believe really, cancer doesn't necessarily have one ideology. And that's what I think that separates us from a lot other practitioners, because we try to find what that ideology is. Why did they get it? Because, you can help them get rid of cancer, but if you didn't get rid of why they got it, they're likely to get it again. So we want to find out. Now, that said, we may never find out the complete, ideology. There could be more than one reason, multifaceted. So, we do throw the book at them, because we all need it. I mean, there's so much stress right now, in life, that that definitely plays a part of it. And every single patient that comes in tells me, about 2 years ago, I was in, I had a paramount amount of stress. Yeah. Okay. There you go. It's like that's the straw that breaks the camel's back, but then what was before that? Oh yeah, I smoked and, okay, well that didn't help, and was that the only thing that caused it, smoking? Well, probably not, Oh yeah, I ate GMO. So there's many things. So we just try to educate individuals to, make the right choices. Or I even believe that, sometimes you just kind of, you can say bless your food, but I kind of say, I'll accept all the nutrients and out goes the bad, mm-hmm. And, sometimes you have to go, as you're traveling cross country or whatever, you may have to stop at a place you wouldn't normally stop at. I don't want you to stress about it.
Yeah, that's a good way to put it. So when you said ozone therapy, do you mean the type where they take the blood out and then pump ozone into it and then pump the blood back in?
Well, that is a type. But I'm also talking about sometimes we use it in insufflation, or We can use it in, we have a sauna that we use it in as well. So,
okay.
Like, you know, we, like I said, we do many things. We really want to detox the body. We want to get a lot of, you know, the toxins out.
For sure. And mistletoe, maybe you could explain that a little bit. I'm not familiar with that one.
Well, it's that thing that hangs up around Christmas, you know, on, no, no, it's actually not. Yeah, don't go eating it or anything like that. So, no, you know, mistletoe, viscum, albitus, vitus, viscum, mallee, they're different types of mistletoe. And, it really grows in Germany in like the Black Forest. And, it kind of started out with where they, a long time ago, they kind of looked at a tree and it looked barren. And, but growing in the tree was this like perfectly round, bushel of like mistletoe. And so it's like, it looked like, this could be a, you know, cancerous patient, you know, with, you know, the cachexia and malnourishment. Hmm. And then, they have, you know, this, you know, like tumor, growing. And so, you know, we kind of look at that and we go, oh, wow, you know, that kind of looks like that. And that's how some of, medicine started, you know, and then they started to use that and they realized, hey, this really does help the immune system, or it can kill, you know, some cancer mainly it's really immunomodulatory. It also stops angiogenesis, you know, or it causes angiogenesis, which is the growth of new blood vessels.
Yeah, that's really interesting because I did a podcast a while back on lumbrokinase, which is an enzyme that comes from earthworms.
Uh-huh.
And it was first discovered by, you know, the Chinese through Chinese medicine. And they looked at earthworms that were burrowing through the ground and kind of making new pathways. And so they theorized, okay, if we eat these earthworms, you know, if we grind them up and make it into a tea or something, that this will also help blood flow, because it will kind of be like you're, you know, burrowing into your blood veins and making, you know, blood flow there. And interestingly enough, you know, thousands of years later, we discover that lumbrokinase can kind of thin your blood. It can eat up fibrin, and so it can increase blood flow. So it's just kind of crazy when those discoveries get made from just observation.
Right. Yeah. No. That's exactly how they've done it. So that's interesting. I didn't know that about lumbrokinase, but we do use it as mainly, you know, it's like kind of to thin the blood, or also to get, you know, open up things for, they use it in Lyme treatment a lot. Mm-hmm. As well. So, and we know cancers are very hyperviscous. So, lumbrokinase is a really good thing to do naturally.
Yeah. So is there anything that you, any treatments that you guys have had that you thought were good at first, but maybe, after a couple of years of using it, or maybe some new research came out that you looked back and you're like, you know, this isn't really good for cancer. Like anything that you guys have left behind?
Let me think.
Because there's a lot. I mean, if you look up, you know, natural cancer therapies, there's a ton of them. And so I'm sure people would want to know if one or two of those things that you've found in your experience are like, you know, this is just really not worth your time.
You know, no, they're so individual, kind of like, you know, I think I often said that with the Budwig diet, but, you know, some people do it and then they're like, oh yeah, I did well with it. And I'm like, okay, you know, huh. So that's not necessarily something I promote, but I don't stop someone from doing it if they want to, you know, mix some flax and cottage cheese. We're not big supporters of dairy, but if they want to do that, I'm okay with it.
Yeah. Gotcha.
So it doesn't hurt them. Nothing. So that's kind of where I like draw the line.
Okay. So if somebody is doing these treatments, what are some of the sacrifices that people might have to make to really get the full benefits?
The sacrifice?
Yeah. You know, a lot of times people will, I don't know. I mean, changing their diet, that's a small one. You know, it's like, oh, I have to leave behind these foods that I really like, and now I have to eat this new diet or something like that. You know, basically I'm asking, what do you ask of people? Like, you're going to have to make these sacrifices to really get through this. Or maybe there's no sacrifices. I'm not sure.
Well, that again is individual, because for some people, right, changing their diet's not a big deal. And for others, I might have asked them the absolute worst thing. so that's, you know, they can't make that sacrifice. Smoking would be another one. I can say, this, you need to stop this. And you know, that might be something that they cannot do. Those are, you know, the main ones. But what I find is, you know, sometimes people, you know, they'll come and they'll do the program. But, you know, at night they go home and then we find out later on, like they ate at McDonald's or something. And you know, it's kind of like, well, do you, you know, how well do you want to do? you know, like it's not necessarily about eating a hamburger per se, but, you know, just looking at the quality of food. So, although, you know, we can look at meats, you know, in general shouldn't be eaten with grains. So, you know, it really depends on even that individual. If they're coming with a colon cancer, you know, I really want them to be very, you know, attentive to their diet.
Yeah. How important is diet change? Because, you know, I always think of diet as kind of helping over the long term. And if you get cancer, then like theoretically, you kind of need some big changes fast, right?
Yeah. And I think that diet is very important. You know, let food be thy medicine, medicine be thy food, you know. So if we're looking at that, food is, you know, food is very huge on what people eat. We can say that juicing, for instance, is where, you know, you're adding a ton of different, very nutrient-rich vegetables and putting them, you know, into a glass and drinking all those nutrients. And you really wouldn't be able to eat that much if it were actual food. But as a juice, you can get a lot of nutrients in a bottle. And so that is, diet is huge. And but one of the things I try to get people to understand, and I realize a lot of people aren't going to change their diet forever. Mm-hmm. They're not going to be strict and stuff forever. So what I really want to encourage people to do is not that you have to go raw or you have to go vegan, because I don't think that that's going to be practical for many people, but that you have to pick good choices. So you have to have organic food. You need to have organic food. You know, the environmental working group does tell you which foods are most important to have organic and which ones you can kind of, you know, maybe fudge and not have organic. So, you know, you have little information cards on that. And so you do need to pick that. And I think that you need to stay away from processed foods. You need to stay away from GMO foods. And we need to pick things that, like, you know, if you can name the ingredient in it, then you can eat it. So, you know, like what's in an apple? Apple, you know, what's in, you know, a boxed product? I don't know, you know, so that's kind of the rule of thumb, you know, and you can pretty much go many places with that rule of thumb.
Yeah. I had an old mentor who used to say, you know, if you can't pronounce it, spit it out. If it tastes good, spit it out. It was a little,
yeah, right.
A little extreme there. He didn't eat very tasty food, but yeah, it was definitely a philosophy that I grew up with.
When you say that, that's interesting because, you know, people, you know, sometimes, you know, there's some people love our food that we have here and then some hate it. And it really is going to depend on what they have been eating themselves. So the more you eat this way, the better you like it and the more you crave it, your taste buds will change. So when someone tells me, you know, oh, I don't like this food, well, then I'm going to know, you know, what they're eating. I mean, that's just, you know, I go, okay, well, I know why, you know, but if you're used to eating real food, you know, and a variety of food, a variety of whole foods, I mean, not just, you know, eating broccoli, but having, you know, a large variety of different, you know, greens and rainbow colored foods.
Hmm. So yeah, you guys serve food. So what kind of foods do you guys generally serve?
At this time, we are letting them pick from various restaurants around that are, you know, the healthiest that we can find. So, you know, and we buy, you know, organic juices. So we're looking at, you know, we give them a menu and then we cross out what they can't have or, you know, certain items in the food, you know, sorry, no, not that one, you know.
Yeah.
And, you know, but really, I think overall they're, you know, pretty, I think, I mean, it's great food, very good restaurants. So.
Wow. So my next question is about the critics, because there is a lot of criticism of naturopathic treatments for cancer. So what do some of the critics say about the treatments, and what would the what would your response be to those criticisms?
Well, yes, there are a lot of you know, people who say that this won't work, and you know, natural medicine doesn't work. You know, that it's a waste of time, it's a waste of money. And I think that we have to look at this, you know, realistically. Here, we do an integrative approach. I'm not afraid of that. I do not think that, you know, drugs per se are the, you know, are going to be it. We don't have a drug deficiency, but they can help someone, you know, feel better, you know, in a quicker format. And then we can go and, you know, help them, you know, and help balance their body after that. So, yes, I think that, you know, sometimes, you know, when we think that we can do stuff, they're looking and going, oh, yeah, this isn't working. You know, we see a lot of the patients from natural clinics, you know, go into the ER. And, but a lot of times those patients might, you know, have tried, you know, chemo and radiation and surgery, and that's got them nowhere. So, and then they're told, you know, just go home. So what are they going to do? You know, and I think if we look at to work together, we're going to get further.
Hmm. Yeah. Why do you think some of the treatments work on some people and not others? I mean, is there something that you can tell from either the patient's attitude or test that kind of tell you like, you know, I don't think these treatments are going to help them that much?
Yes. That's a great question. I do. There's a saying by Sir William Osler that says the organs weep the tears, the eyes refuse to shed. And, so that tells me sometimes when someone comes in and they've got a cancer in a certain area, you know, then I start to, you know, ask them questions regarding, you know, their, you know, what's going on in their life. And that usually can tell a lot of things. And so I'm listening to how a patient words things and says things. And I'll know, you know, oftentimes where they're at in terms of healing. And I know that, you know, that does sound hokey right there, but the mental, emotional aspect of healing is significant. And, you know, number one, I need to know from the patient that they feel that the, you know, the human body can heal. You know, that's number one. If they don't think that they can, if they think they're doomed ahead of time, well, then forget it. That's not going to work. But if they believe that, yeah, the human body can heal, then I absolutely. And I think you have to get to the point where, you know, that you don't have a doubt on whether or not something's going to work. You just know. So there was a book written in like 1941, and he said, you know, the way to healing, you know, there's many paths to the way to healing. It doesn't mean, you know, you could do chemotherapy, you can do natural medicine, you can do osteopathic medicine or chiropractic. But if you believe it's going to work, then it does. And that kind of throws in the placebo effect.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, we really have to look at that because, you know, a placebo effect is, in fact, a very real effect. And the reverse of that, we can say, so is the nocebo effect. We can just take away someone's hope by something that we say.
Yeah, it's really too bad that the placebo effect has such a bad reputation among scientists, because it's kind of like, in another age, it'd just be called like a good attitude or, you know, it's a travesty that it gets treated so poorly. Like, oh, it's just a placebo effect, but it's like, you know, it actually kind of worked. So, there's that.
Right. I mean, well, we know, based on a lot of the work of like Joe Dispenza, Bruce Lipton, David Hawkins, you know, we know that, what our mind believes really can manifest in our body. And so, you know, if we take an individual who, you know, has been shamed and, you know, feels guilty, you know, those are the precursors of disease. So we turn around, you know, and if we learn to change that and start, you know, loving our body and loving all of ourselves, you know, we're really going to be in a hugely different environment.
Yeah. So,
and I think that promotes healing.
So if somebody has a bad attitude or they don't believe, what do you do? I mean, do you send them to therapy?
No. I ask them why they're here, you know, I don't want someone to spend their money on something they don't believe in. You know, that's hard, you know, even for the workers to do if they do that. I think pain is another one. Like, you know, a patient can be so positive, but the minute they feel pain, all of a sudden they can't think past it. And so that is a tough one. But what we all can learn from this is to learn how to deal with it now, not necessarily pain, but learn how to make these to have, I'm going to use the word faith, basically, because if faith is something that there's no like scale. It's either you have it or you don't. You can't have 50% of it, you know. So it's something you go, yeah, I have or own. And people, you know, oftentimes are, oh, yeah, I have hope, I have faith. Then they get pain. And then all of a sudden they don't. So it's something that we can learn to practice in our life early on and say, look at, okay, you know, with anything, we don't have to, it doesn't even have to be a sickness or, you know, a disease that we're exercising this. We're exercising it on anything that we do. You know, if we have stress, you know, we have to learn to be like, okay, yeah, I didn't pay a bill. Okay. You know, I'll do what I can, you know, like, yeah, it's not detrimental if I don't pay a bill. I mean, it could be detrimental if a lion is chasing me, you know, so we have to learn where to stress and where not. I mean, we cannot continue to have fight and flight 24 hours a day.
Yeah. That makes me kind of curious. Do you find that a lot of your patients have the same like emotional phenotype where, you know, a lot of them are like super anxious or, you know, they're a depressive type or anything like that?
Yeah. Now that you say that, I would say that anxiety is a big one, but that's also like the number one diagnosed disease in America, you know, and prescribed are, you know, anti-anxiolytics or antidepressants. So, yeah, I mean, that's a tough one, but I think that's all part of, you know, culturally, we're not learning to deal with it, you know, we're either medicating it, but we need to like stop and kind of like, you know, just determine, is this significant? No. All right.
Yeah. And it's probably tough to answer whether, you know, maybe they're anxious because they have cancer or is their anxiety there before cancer and it's feeding the cancer. It's probably kind of a chicken and the egg problem there.
Right. Yeah, no, I always bring up the chicken and the egg. Yeah. So you're absolutely right. You know, I think in some maybe there's more anxiety before that, but then or there's anxiety after they get diagnosed. But when I talk to some people, they're like, you know, then they're control freaks and, you know, and they want to control everything. And, you know, I'm like, well, you just got to let it go, you know, and that's not something I can necessarily teach to someone. I do try, if we're in a situation where I see that they're doing that and I'm like, okay, I have to let it go. This is what I, you know, this is it, but that's, you know, I can't get in their head, yet. So, I'm working on it now. But that's a big deal. And we do, we do an e-box, and that's kind of where it's kind of, you know, like frequency based. And our e-box, practitioner is really phenomenal. And she really will, you know, she gets down to it. She, you know, she'll end up by like, you know, what happened in 1982? You know, everyone's like, what? You know, I mean, it's really phenomenal.
I don't think I've ever heard of that. What is an e-box?
So there's this company, Zyto, and they have made like a cradle, and you put your hand on the cradle as, you know, you just kind of put your hand on the cradle as it goes through like this program. And then like these, this comes up like on kind of like your affirmations or where you're at in, different aspects of your, life. Like, are you stressed about money or financial, or do you love what you do, and different things of like that. And then of course there's also the Zydo program that can tell you if you have, viruses or, I don't know, whatever, organ damage or teeth, whatever. But it's different. It's frequency. So, for instance, someone, HIV could come up on somebody, but that doesn't mean that if I went and tested them for HIV, that they would have it. It merely can mean that maybe they have a part of that protein sequence, or they've been around someone that had it, it's a little different. Or sometimes, like, if hepatitis comes up, it might mean that they're angry. So there's ways to kind of look at it. It's, that's why you probably have to be certified to do it. But when we use the EVOX program in more of a mental, emotional way, it really is very fascinating. And then with that, they can, you do a program to help, like, clear those areas. So, we're doing that. And I think that's the biggest work we can do in a 6-week time frame, to help them. Otherwise, this is probably the biggest aspect, I think, that, going back to that question, yes, actually, I would say this is one of the biggest things that we can do for someone is the mental, emotional.
Gotcha. So are there new treatments that are maybe being studied right now, or, new natural therapies that you guys are looking into that may be on the horizon?
Gosh, there's always stuff.
Is there anything particularly that you're excited about?
I'm always doing everything. You go to a conference and you find out about all these different things that are available, and it's mind-boggling. There's just so many different things out there, and one could classify them as thinking, okay, that can't work. I mean, I've done that so many times. Like, oh yeah, that I read the ingredients and go, nope, can't work. And I've learned not to do that, because I've seen it firsthand, where a patient might try something, and I'm like, oh, now this is interesting, we do have, we're always trying new things, and it gets exciting. So sometimes when I feel like, oh, what else can I do? I mean, something always comes up, that can be done.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. Great. So we probably got, 15, 20 minutes left. I know one of the questions that people are probably going to have is about cost and what people can expect from these treatments. So, can you give any ballpark numbers?
Our cost is for 6 weeks. It's actually like $10,000 a week, but if, a patient pays up front, then we would discount it by $20,000. So we do about $40,000. And as I said, one of the benefits to this program is that everything, is included, really. If you need, pain medicine, we might use insurance for that, and things like that. But if we have it here, we give it, supplements, you need it. We give, the first, month of supplements, but basically we're available to them, forever. As long as that patient's alive, they have our phone numbers. They can pick us up, pick up the phone and call us. And we'll be like, okay, yeah, let's, get some imaging, scheduled, or a lab, or, whatever we need to do. So that's one of the things, like, if a patient goes to Mexico, because I would say that, Mexico can do maybe some things that we can't do, for instance, like dendritic cell therapy, vaccines, which I don't care that we can't do those. So, but if, they want to go there and do it, one of the things that when they return back to the U.S., and, those doctors there can't get them imaging, can't, you know, run labs on them. They would have to return to Mexico. And so that's a big deal, is that the fact that we're going to be following them forever.
Yeah. So it sounds like it's kind of like an all-inclusive stay at a resort, meaning it's kind of a big upfront cost, but you get free drinks and however much food you want.
Right. That's a good way to put it. You know, and it is, but this is, you know, someone's life. So, you know, we don't, if you pay, you know, you take a person that, you know, comes in sometimes and they're like, oh, I read about artesunate, I want to do that. And you're like, okay, but by itself, you know, that's just one thing, you know, like,
yeah,
you know, I don't know how great that's
going to
be.
So will you do a single therapy if somebody wants it? Like, hey, I just want to do the ozone. Like, would you do that? Or is it kind of like, no, you really have to get the whole package?
No, I would do it. But I mean, not, but I will, you know, tell them what I think. I mean, not that I'm trying to like get them to do the thing. I just want them to, you know, understand that sometimes it's, we don't know, you know, like we do throw everything but the kitchen sink at it. So what was it worked? I mean, sometimes intuitively, I know what works, you know, what's working on this person or what's working on that. But yeah, you know, ozone's different, you know, that's kind of a different deal. But, but sometimes, you know, we're just using, I don't know, we can find a lot of different things that are going to work, and they're going to work synergistically or additively. So that's how we're going to, you know, look at the patient. So sometimes just doing one, you know, I'm like, okay, that's great. But you know, I think you can do much more. So it's tough. You know, I don't want a patient to unwisely spend their, you know, hard earned money. I feel for that. So
sure.
I really want them to get the most out of it. And, you know, and oftentimes, you know, people always say like, well, you know, what can I do? You know, how can I make it cheaper? And well, I mean, I think, you know, honestly, if you can do surgery, that's one of the biggest things that may be a good thing to do. And at least I say that at this time in my career, because they don't, you know, the only thing that they can call a cure basically is a surgical cure, you know? So, if a patient can have that, done, that does not mean that the cancer hasn't spread, but at least they think it hasn't at this time. And that's kind of the hope that, you know, they'll only do surgery if they know, if they, like, imaging shows it hasn't spread. But imaging can only show you so much. So it may have spread. You just don't know. And that's why we get recurrence, right? So, you know, we want to do whatever we can in combination with that. So if they can have surgery, they may not have to stay 6 weeks. They may, you know, do a 4-week program.
Gotcha. Gotcha. Okay. So I would love to hear, and I'm sure the audience would love it too, if you could share a story of a person or maybe multiple people who recovered from cancer and what their process was. I mean, obviously leave out any personal details, but just kind of like a good detail of like, this is what they came in for, this is how we approached it, and this is their success.
Yeah. Oftentimes, like, patients come in and, you know, like, let's say they have a breast mass, they've already had it biopsied, or maybe they haven't had a biopsy, and, you know, we have to look at it and we can, you know, palpate it and, you know, kind of have an idea, this doesn't look good. So, or it's suspicious for malignancy. You know, we might just have that removed. Oftentimes if they're past a certain size, or we find out histologically they're a certain type, like maybe HER2 positive, then we know they're a little more aggressive. So I did have a patient who, you know, came in with a triple positive cancer, and, you know, in discussion, you know, she chose to have surgery. So we did that, and which was great, you know, and seemingly, oh, hey, it's out and it's gone. But, you know, like, as I was saying, if it's a certain size, you know, there's that likelihood or, you know, propensity that it has spread. And even though they may get what we call, you know, clear margins, that doesn't matter. And there's, you know, there was a group of Israelis that actually, that showed kind of like, you know, just because you have, you know, what we consider clear margins, they kind of like brought like the camera up a little higher, and they went, oh, but look, there's cancer still everywhere, you know, cancer cells. And So that said, you know, I you know, did a lot of IV therapy and, you know, different treatments. And then also used a product on her that was a topical, and that would actually, you know, penetrate into the skin and just by the nature of it would kill abnormal cells. So it would do that. And we, you know, at that point we saw that she had some eruptions on, and, you know, in both armpits. So that, you know, tells me that it would have come back. And we were able to do that treatment. And, you know, hey, that wasn't fun, you know, for her. But now, you know, she's fine. So, and that was, you know, a couple of years ago. So she's still doing great. No recurrence, nothing, you know. So, and that's good. And we, you know, and that's the thing is we continue to monitor. I don't want, you know, I don't want it coming back. You know, so I'm going to, you know, do labs and imaging or something every so often.
Okay.
You know, and just check her out. Yeah.
Okay. So basically for her, it was a topical treatment. Did you guys do other things on her, like ozone or any of those other things you mentioned?
All of that. Yeah. I mean, we did, you know, she had all those types of treatments, ozone and IV therapy and, you know, supplements, you know, all that. So she, but she's doing fantastic. But she was just someone who was like, all right, I'm going to do what you say. And I was like, okay, you know, but tell me how you're feeling, you know, as we go along, you know, so we had a very good communication and then it worked well. And I'm very excited about that. It's not a route I go all the time with individuals, you know, to use that because it's not fun, but, definitely it works if you can, continue it. So she did it.
All right. So as we wrap up here, I usually like to ask my guests this question. It's just kind of off the cuff, you know, whatever comes to your mind first. But of all the health advice that you hear in the media, online, you know, maybe in the news sources, what advice do you think, like, man, this is just the worst health advice?
There's probably a lot of them. But if I'm going to relate it to cancer, I'm going to say that when they tell an individual, you're clear of cancer, you're clear. And that person has this false sense of, you know, security that they don't have cancer there anymore because imaging's not picking it up. So imaging's clear. And I think that that's great, but it is a false sense of security because those circulating cancer cells, you know, are what go around and plant into, you know, other organs and cause metastasis. So.
Yeah.
There's things that need to be done, you know, even if you were to do a conventional, you know, chemotherapy or radiation, you need those two things do not kill the circulating tumor cells, the circulating stem cells or circulating cancer cells. They don't kill them. So you have to do something else. And right now we don't have those medications for that. So I'm sure that the, you know, pharmaceutical companies are trying to come up with something, but at this point, no, we don't. So it is very important that patients continue to, you know, try to really detoxify their body. That's one of the big things is we're so much more toxic than we were a decade ago.
Yeah. Well, are there any other topics that you wanted to hit on before we call this a game?
Let's see, probably zombies, really into them.
Yeah, there's a lot of zombies out there these days. NPCs, they're called.
Yeah.
They just follow orders.
Right. Yeah. No, I always laugh. I'm always thinking, I wonder if this treatment would work on a zombie. So, you know, I'm like, yeah.
So how can people find you online? How can they learn more about, your facilities and all that stuff?
Brio-medical.com. We're there, all about us. And, we're in Scottsdale, Arizona, and we're open 5 days a week. And, you know, I think people love it. They have a lot of fun here.
All right. Are you writing any books or, I don't know, doing anything online yourself?
Not currently. I used to think that, the people who wrote the books were probably not the ones that were the best practitioners, but, you know, now So I guess that's kept me from it. But yeah, I'll, you know, maybe one day I will. I don't know. You know, I'm more interested right in treating patients, so, and helping them.
Great. Well, thank you so much for coming on.
Yeah, Lucas, thanks for having me.
All right. That was Dr. Kollin from Brio Medical. I enjoyed talking to her. I was surprised at how positive she was about surgery and mainstream cancer therapies like chemotherapy. It does sound like they treat a lot of people who do both conventional and alternative treatments simultaneously. So that was pretty interesting. She was very careful about what she said natural therapies were capable of as well. But I do think we still got some good nuggets of information that I want to summarize real quick. So, to me, it sounds like there is a base level of therapy that everybody gets who goes to Brio. So everybody gets ozone, everybody gets IVs like vitamin C, sauna therapy, and I'm sure there's probably many others. And then on top of that, there is going to be some type of specialized treatment like she was describing with the topical for the woman with breast cancer. It sounds like that was more of a unique thing. So that sounds like their basic plan. Now, like she said, this is going to run you $40,000 for 6 weeks of treatment. And man, when I first heard that number, I was kind of like, oh, that is a chunk of change right there, and I am in the wrong business. But the more I thought about it, the more reasonable it does seem. What you're paying for is something like I mentioned in the interview, which is like an all-inclusive hotel deal. So if you've ever stayed in an all-inclusive hotel, you pay more upfront, but you don't have to worry about the cost of anything while you're there. So you can order as much food and drinks as you like. And so it gives you this degree of freedom that really increases the enjoyment of your stay at the hotel. But the way they structure it is you will never end up eating or drinking more than what it cost you up front. You know, they're always going to make a little bit of money on that deal, unless you're, you know, just completely gluttonous. So to bring it back to the cancer treatment, you could technically go and get all of these different treatments that she described piecemeal, and you could purchase each one separately for less. And for someone like me, who is very familiar with most of these treatments, that may be worth it to save that money. But if you want to have someone experienced guide you, and you know, you don't want to think about, okay, I'm doing this over here, I'm doing that over there, you know, Brio seems like a good option for that. And you aren't really going to save as much money as you think buying it piecemeal either. So for example, I was thinking about numbers in my head, and good ozone therapy, that can run you $500 a pop. Like if you get the multiple runs where they pull the blood out of you and pump it back in and ozonate it, and they do that multiple times, that could be $500. So I mean, if you're doing that 3 to 5 times per week, you're looking at maybe $12,000 for 6 weeks of treatment. And that's a fourth of the cost right there. And that's not counting any of the other treatments. So, you know, the more I thought about it, the more reasonable it does seem. I mean, it's still a lot of money, obviously, but they aren't ripping you off. You know, they're providing a service that I think many people are going to find some value in. I thought it was interesting that she said ozone therapy and mistletoe were heavy hitters for a lot of people. I've also heard that ozone can be particularly effective for cancer, so it's cool that she reinforced that. I've never heard of mistletoe, though. And actually, my roommate shared something interesting with me when I told him this. He said that Herb Farm, which is a big herbal company, used to have a mistletoe, and they took it off the market for some mysterious reason a couple years ago. So I thought that was interesting. But not really sure how that would be used. You'd have to do your own research on the mistletoe there. I also noticed that she was really careful through the whole interview not to talk negatively about any of the treatment options out there. This is something I really wanted her to do. Like, I love it when I can cross some potential herb or, you know, whatever off my list. And I wanted her to be like, oh yeah, you know, these things don't work. Don't waste your time. So I could be like, all right, cool. Going forward, I can not even think about those treatments. But what I came to understand is she's trying to avoid the nocebo effect. And I really didn't even think about this angle, but the nocebo effect is when you actually take someone's hope away about a treatment and it makes it less likely that treatment will work. So cancer is a disease where your attitude matters a lot to your outcome. And if someone is doing a therapy and they think, man, this really works, and she says this treatment is crap, that could end up killing the person who really believed in it and they had some hope around it. And just like she said, there were treatments that she didn't think worked. I think she mentioned flaxseed and cottage cheese or something, some diet like that, which I think I've heard of. But anyway, she mentioned that, and then somebody would use it and believe in it, and they would recover. Now, part of my mind kind of rebels at this whole notion, because I want to say, you know, what works, works. What doesn't work, doesn't work. Be objective, be a scientist. But I can see her point about the nocebo effect and not wanting to take people's hope away. I think that does make it hard to find out what really works and what doesn't. But really, who am I to say, oh, you need to sacrifice to find out whether this therapy works or not? Because that's what I do all the time. I mean, I try new things. I find out if they work. But my life isn't on the line. You know, at worst, I feel kind of crummy for a few days. If I had cancer, well, the stakes for experimenting and finding that truth would definitely be higher. So that was definitely a learning moment for me during this interview. And the last thing I want to mention is that when I told people about this interview, one thing everybody asked me was what the success rate was for Brio, at which point I realized that I had not asked Dr. Kollin that question. Sometimes questions skip my mind, I guess. So I emailed her and I asked her, and she replied. So I'm going to paraphrase what she said. It's very hard to get proper statistics because she treats people ranging from very ill, so maybe stage 3 or 4 cancer, to not very ill, maybe stage 1 cancer. So proper statistics are tough to get. They're often also heavily manipulated, the ones that you do see. So you don't really see their methodology in a way that gives you the truth of those statistics. Now, often the people who are at her clinic are also doing conventional therapy at the same time. So teasing out those accurate statistics in a clinic like her, in a clinic like hers, it's impossible. With that said, she reiterates that she has seen the body heal even in the illest of people. So kind of a disappointing answer. It would be nice if she said, you know, we have a 65% success rate with stage 3 cancer and a 85% with stage 2, et cetera, et cetera. But there is a reason that these are called alternative therapies. The data just isn't there. So for example, if you look up ozone therapy for cancer, you're going to find a bunch of data suggesting it may be a great add-on therapy in cancer, you know, and they're going to have the data from animals and in vitro, but there's not going to be much in the way of large double-blind studies. So bottom line with this whole question, we just don't know. Other than that, I do want to know what your thoughts were on the interview. So leave a comment on YouTube or Twitter, or you can shoot me an email at quackspodcast@gmail.com. I will give you a response. If you want to chat with Dr. Kollin or find out more about treatment, give Brio a call. I'm sure they'd be happy to walk you through their process in more depth. I do have their website in the show notes where you can contact them. So I think that's it for this week. Thanks so much for listening, guys. Be well.